Hey, what's up everyone? It's Matt, and I want to read you an interesting passage. A study of new diagnoses of kidney cancer in the 3,141 counties of the United States reveals a remarkable pattern. The counties in which the incidence of kidney cancer is the lowest are mostly rural, sparsely populated, and located in traditionally Republican states in the Midwest, the South, and the West. What do you make of this? This example is provided by the statisticians Howard Wehner and Harris Zwirling, and yeah, what do we make of the fact that the counties with those descriptions are those with the lowest rates of kidney cancer in the US? So when I first read this, I thought, alright, this probably isn't related to the fact that it's a Republican area that isn't in the North. It probably has something to do with the idea that it's a rural area, right? There isn't as much water pollution, or air pollution, or food additives. And the authors even comment, "It is both easy and tempting to infer that their low cancer rates are directly due to the clean living of the rural lifestyle." Now, Wehner and Zwirling also offer a description of the counties in the US where kidney cancer is most prevalent, and I'll read it to you. "These ailing counties tend to be mostly rural, sparsely populated, and located in traditionally Republican states in the Midwest, the South, and the West. These high kidney cancer rates are likely due to these counties being very rural. In rural areas, you don't have access to the best healthcare, and more people are likely to use tobacco and alcohol, and there are more high-fat diets. In fact, the authors even comment, "It is easy to infer that their high cancer rates might be directly due to the poverty of the rural lifestyle." Okay, you can tell by this point that something is going on, but the authors are not lying about any of the things they said, so what's happening here? This example is found in Daniel Kahneman's book, Thinking Fast and Slow. It's a fantastic read, and I've actually made another video on it, which I'll put up in the cards. Now, obviously, high and low instances of kidney cancer can't both be caused by a rural setting. In fact, as Kahneman explains, none of the descriptions you see here are what causes this variability. The real determining factor here is simply that the counties are small. Let's say you have a big city represented by 12 people. A circle means you won't develop kidney cancer in your life, and an X means that you will. Now, I'm gonna put these into this bowl with 12 more pieces of paper just like these. Together, there will be 24, 12 circles and 12 X's. I'm going to randomly draw from these, and this will create a population of 12 that gives us a specific rate for kidney cancer in this city. As you can see here, there are 6 circles and 6 X's, so the rate of kidney cancer is 50%. I did this 19 more times for a total of 20 hypothetical cities, and here you can see the kidney cancer rates of these cities. Now I'm going to do the same thing, but instead of a city, I'm going to make a small county. There will only be 4 people in these counties, and we will draw them from an equal pool of circles and X's. The first time I did this, I again got 50%, but as I did this 19 more times, look at the results I got. The smaller counties were much more likely to have a really high or really low rate of kidney cancer. And this shows us something about the nature of sampling from different sized populations. Statistically, extreme examples happen more frequently in smaller populations than in larger ones. And the small sample size does not cause anything, it just allows extreme things like this to happen more frequently. Now, we know that the bigger a sample size is, the more likely it will be accurate and representative of the larger population. This is known as the law of large numbers. So Kahneman and his research partner Amos Tversky coined the term the law of small numbers to mean that we treat conclusions from small sample sizes the same way we treat conclusions from large sample sizes. That is, we place too much confidence in them and often generalize those results erroneously. According to Kahneman, this happens because we don't intuitively understand statistics that well. Our minds naturally search for relationships and patterns and causes. So when something weird happens and the only reason is just because it was a small sample size, it's hard to wrap our minds around that. We want to say something like, no, it probably happened because they weren't from the north or because it was a rural area. Even Kahneman says that he's a poor intuitive statistician, and I am myself. I didn't get this when I first read it. If you did happen to correctly guess the example from before, maybe it's because you've heard that before, or you're one of the few people who intuitively do understand statistics that well, or maybe you just guessed it from the title of this video, because that probably wasn't too difficult. Here's another example of how we can be poor intuitive statisticians. Which of these sequences of births of boys and girls is most likely? Our intuitive answer is to say it's the last one, the one that looks the most random, because we all know there's basically a 50-50 chance of having a boy or a girl. But in reality, all of those sequences are equally likely to occur. This does seem counterintuitive, so let's use a simpler example to demonstrate this. Say a couple will have 2 children. These are all the possible outcomes they can experience. Now, as you see here, having 2 sons is less likely than having 1 daughter and 1 son, But because each sequence is unique, the double boy sequence is just as likely as either of the boy-girl combinations. Bringing this back to the previous example, yes, it is more likely that you'll wind up with a 3-3 or 4-2 split if you look at just the end total of boys and girls. But when we look at these as a sequence instead of a total end result, each is equally likely because the first child has a 50-50% chance of being a boy or a girl, and so does the next, and so does the next, and the next, and the next, and the next. Despite how unlikely the first and second sequence here seem, they are just as likely, just as random, as the last sequence. There are tons of relevant and important examples of our poor intuitive understanding of statistics, like how military bombings of London in World War II were assumed to be intentional and targeted when they were likely random, and how the idea of basketball players having a hot hand is nothing more than statistical randomness. But I want to leave you with one that stood out to me. Some time ago, there was a big research effort to identify some characteristics of the most successful schools in America. One of the conclusions of this research is that many of the successful schools were small, and in Pennsylvania, 6 of the top 50 best schools were small, which is an overrepresentation by a factor of 4. This encouraged the Gates Foundation to make an investment of $1.7 billion, along with other groups like the Pew Charitable Trust and certain programs in the Department of Education, all aimed at making schools smaller. Now, when we first think about it, it makes sense that smaller schools will do better. Teachers have more time to spend with individual students, and they get to know them better. But if you've been watching this video, and if you knew that this example is provided by the same two statisticians who provided the very first example, then you probably know that something else is going on here, that maybe this is just an error of sampling, not a causal effect. The small size of the school didn't cause anything, it just allowed for more extreme results to occur. Yes, the best schools in America are disproportionately small, but so are the worst ones. Statistics produce results that aren't always explained by causality, and yet that's how we try to explain it anyway, because that's how our minds work. And that's why we sometimes invest time and effort and $1.7 billion into building schools that are just as likely to be terrible as they are great. I'll see you later. I highly recommend reading Thinking Fast and Slow. If I were sponsored by Audible, I would... that's what I'd be talking up right now. Also, funny story. So when I was doing the sampling for the large county and small county, I first just did 10 trials of each instead of 20, and I got results that, while still accurate, didn't really show the point too well. And so I did 10 more of each, and then they started looking more like a random distribution. And it's funny because I was getting kind of upset when I only got the first couple of results that didn't illustrate the point too well, and then I realized I'm letting what I'm talking about happen right here. I did a really small sample size and tried to show you something, and you're more likely to have extreme results when you have a small sample size. So in this case, the extreme result was that the results that should look extreme didn't look too extreme. So this is a very easy bias to succumb to. That's it for me. Thanks. I will see you later.